Good morning. We are going to have a good day today. We're going to worship the Lord. We're going to take some time and remember what Memorial Day is about. And for just so you know that, it's not about everybody that ever served. It's for those that went to serve and never came home. We are in the Gospel of Luke, as you heard, chapter 23, verses 44 through 46. So Memorial Day weekend unofficially begins the official summer season, right? This is when people that have gone to the beach or headed to the beach for the weekend, those that are fortunate enough to have pools, you know, the local public pools are opening up for the season today or tomorrow, or maybe they opened up yesterday. I don't know. It's been a while since I've been in a public pool. But it means that you're going to be spending more time outside, right? But have you ever noticed that whether you're at the beach or whether you're at a pool, that you ever watch people get in the water? Do people get in the water different ways, right? Yeah, one way is they stick their toe in, right? Then they stick their foot in, and they go in a little bit at a time. You know, they put in as much as they want to get wet. You know, maybe they don't want to get their dew wet, right? So they just get up to their waist, whatever the case is. Then, of course, there's those other people. There's other people that just jump in. Just get it over with and get all wet all at once. Those are the people that are all in, right? They're committed to getting in the water. They're not holding anything back. You know, there's nothing that's dry on them. There's nothing that they're even worried about being dry because they are all in. Well, Memorial Day weekend is about men and women who were all in. They gave their life for this great country that we call America. They held nothing back. They went into conflict knowing that they might not come back. They gave everything. They gave their life for the freedoms that we enjoy. And I think it's appropriate that maybe we should take a moment and salute them with a round of applause. Now today, as you heard Jake read the final words of Christ from the cross, Jesus declared just that. That he was hanging on that cross and that he was all in. So I have to ask you this question. Are you all in when it comes to your relationship with Jesus? Or have you been holding something back? See, that's the problem with today's church, is that so many of us so-called Christians are not all in. Let's look at our scripture today. Try and pick out a couple of observations for us to consider. So in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, verses 44 through 46, our first point this morning is that Jesus set the standard as how much of our life that we should give to God. And that's all in. Was Jesus all in or what? Jesus said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Now, notice he didn't say, "Into your hands I commit most of my spirit." He didn't say, "Into your hands I commit some of my spirit." And notice Jesus didn't say, "Into your hands I commit the parts that I want to give of my spirit." He gave it all. Now, I apologize for this analogy before I give it to you, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. So I don't remember, you know, it's on one of those ESPN channels. You ever see that the thing called the World Poker Tour? Did you ever see that? Well, they have this bunch of men and women that's sitting around these big old tables, right? And they're playing cards, and they got big piles of chips next to them. And, of course, the chips are money, right? And somewhere along the lines, maybe one of them will take all their chips and push it to the middle of the table and say, "I'm all in. I'm all in. I'm giving everything I got into the middle." Now, with that in your mind, I want you to think just for a second, if your life was represented by those chips, could you visualize moving all your chips into the middle of the table, giving them freely to God, and say, "I'm all in"? Or do you feel uncomfortable with that? Do you have trouble dealing with that? And you want to keep some of those chips by your side? Or maybe once you pushed them in the middle, you had second thoughts and you took some of those chips back. There's parts of your life you took back. See, that tells me there's two ways not to give ourselves all the way to God. First way is to hold some of those chips back, right? Don't put them all in. I mean, there are some things in my life that I don't want God control over, because I think I can do a better job taking care of those things than God can. Duh. Right? So as a result, I never move those chips to the center of the table. Now, some of those examples might be our children, our finances. They could be our spouses. I mean, there's a ton of stuff that we might not want to move to the center of the table and give to God that we want to hold on to because we think we can control it better. The second way that it says that I'm less than all in is that I move all my chips to the center of that table. Then I think about it for a second. I take some of those chips back. You know, have you ever come to the Lord and left something with God, but before you finish that conversation, maybe that prayer, maybe before the day was out, you took some of that stuff that you gave to God back? Because you know we all do that, right? I'm giving it to God. I'm giving it to God. I'm going to give it to God, all except for that. That I'm going to hold on to because it's too much for God to handle. I can handle this part. It's not like that. The Bible has examples of both ways of us failing to meet the standard that Jesus set for being all in. And so we want to look at those this morning, which brings me to my second point. Probably everybody in this room has committed some areas of their life to God. But very few of us have committed all of our areas of our life to God. And the standard that Jesus set is that all areas of our life should be given to God. All in. In Matthew chapter 19, verses 16 through 22. And you'll remember this story. God's word said, And behold, one came and said unto him, "Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?" And he said unto him, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, and that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments." He saith unto him, "Which?" Jesus saith, "Thou shalt do no murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." The young man saith unto him, "All these things I have kept from my youth up. What lack I yet?" And Jesus said unto him, "If thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me." But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. You see, brothers and sisters, God's standard of all in is God's standard. And he's not going to change his standard because I struggle, because I fail to meet his standard. It's a holy standard. He can't change it because he's holy. And in our scripture, this man was doing a pretty good job of giving God a bunch of the areas of his life. But I believe that this man, when he asked the question, you know, well, what do I lack? What do I need to have eternal life? He probably thought that Jesus was going to say, you've done good. If you were Sawyer, it'd be two thumbs up. I'm good. He was hoping that Jesus would tell him that. You've done it all. You did a great job going in, giving it all. But instead, Jesus points out to this rich young ruler that you didn't. You haven't put all your finances, your possessions, the things that you own. You haven't given that to God. You have control over them. You're not giving them to me. And I learned two things from the story. The way that you and I are wired may make some things easy for us to give to God. I mean, this rich young ruler had no problem giving parts of his life to God, right? But it also might make things difficult for us to give areas of our life to God. This rich young ruler had a problem giving over his possessions, his riches. He didn't want to give that to God. So much so he walked away from Christ and an eternal life. We don't know what happened. But I know people who have no problem giving their finances to God. They trust God completely with their money. But those same people might be struggling giving God control over their children, to keep control over their kids. And the truth is we all struggle somewhere in some area of our life that we don't give it to the Lord. Any of you guys have that problem? If you don't, let's meet afterwards so you can tell me how you do it. The second thing I learned from this story is that I don't ask God enough, what areas of my life have I not given over to you? Because we have a tendency of blurring that stuff out, don't we? Oh, yeah, I've given him everything. I've given him everything. And we don't see past that blurry part that we've covered up, that where we haven't handed it over to him. Romans 12, verses 1 and 2 tells me, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but ye be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So I should be asking, what other area of my life should I be putting on the altar? That's what we should all be asking. What are y'all holding on to? What haven't you given to the Lord? And let me let you in on a little secret. If you ask that question, what do I need to work on? God is always going to give you an answer. Always going to give you an answer until the day you draw your last breath, he will give you an answer. Now, we might be striving to be like Jesus as we walk on this world, but we won't be like him until we see him face to face. And until that time, we need to keep putting new things on the altar. We need to keep giving it to God. Those parts of our life, we all got ugly parts. We all got pretty parts. But we got to give us. We have to be all in. We have to be. See, that's the problem. We want to hold on to some stuff. And if we look at our life, There are parts of our life that are just a shambles, so we haven't given to him. Why? He's all powerful. He has the answers to everything. He can give you peace, even in a stormy time. And yet, we hold on. Our final point for today is probably everybody in this room at one time and another have given an area of their life over to the Lord and then took it back. Instead of continuing to add to what we give God control over, sometimes we take away what we've already given him. Now, if you had a moment to think, you will find something in your life that you gave to God and then you took back. It could be a guilt. It could be, it could be your offering. You know, you wrote that check for $100 or $150, and then I'm gonna cut that in half. Something. We all do it. There's a story in the Bible of a man named Demas, and there's not a lot known about Demas. There's only three scriptures that talk about him in the New Testament. One is in Colossians, one is in Philemon, and one in 2 Timothy. And we can piece together this man's life, that he had gave his life to the Lord, that he served Jesus, and he was ministering to the Apostle Paul. Now, we first read about him in Colossians 4:14, where the Dr. Luke wrote that him and Demas had sent greetings to Paul. Now, at this time, Paul was in prison, you know, and he was in Rome, and Paul mentions that Luke and Demas were there encouraging him in the faith. And in fact, Paul calls Demas in Philemon 1, chapter 1, verse 24, a fellow laborer. So that would give us the impression that Demas was all in, right? I mean, he was there. He risked his life as a Christian to go to Rome with Paul to minister. I mean, to minister to Paul. But in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, Paul is nearing the end of his life, and Paul writes that Demas has abandoned us and went back to enjoying the things of this world. What Demas had put on the altar, his life, he took it back off, and he decided to live it his way by enjoying the pleasures of the world. Now, before you're too hard on Demas, in my 19-plus years of being here as your pastor, I've seen a whole lot of people come and go just like Demas. You could count on them being here on Sunday morning. Anytime the church doors were open, they were here. They were some of the best workers of the church. But today, they can be best described as hit or miss if they come at all. Some don't come at all. What happened? They decided to take that life back. They didn't leave it on the altar. They didn't give it all to God. We used to have a name for that. They don't use it very much anymore. Backsliding. Right? You know anybody that's backsliding? Lord have mercy. If we had everybody that's come through these doors in my time here, this church would be filled every Sunday with people that have come and gone. You know what's funny and not so funny? Have you ever noticed that when people are having a difficult time in their life, when things are bad, they all of a sudden decide they need Jesus? Then they're here and they're eaten up the word. But soon as things get good, soon as their life turns around, they don't come anymore. They got what they needed from God. They got the support they needed from his people. But they're not here anymore. Until the next problem comes and they show back up. Are they all in? They're conditionally all in, right? Today, we don't hear that word backslidden any very often anymore. And maybe it's because that so many people have taken things back, it's just become so commonplace that we just kind of wash over it. You know, if you say that to a newer Christian, they don't even know what you're talking about. And here's the tragedy, is that our scripture today shows Jesus, our Lord, our the God of creation, is all in. And here we are giving God way less than our all. And that should break our hearts. Because we're all guilty of it. I know that it breaks the heart of our Father. Brothers and sisters, if it breaks your heart, then he's ready for us to be all in. You know, this world has so many choices, right? There's so many things that we can pick. You know, I've said it countless times, but I would not want to be a teenager today, in today's world. It was so much more easy, so much simpler when I was their age. You know, you look to get your driver's license, you know, you look to be able to have a job, you know, you get out of school, but now you have the world crashing in on you every day, every time they pick up a phone, every time they get on a computer, the world is at their fingertips. For the world to come to us, we had to either hear it on the radio, the TV, or in a newspaper, read it in a newspaper, right? You guys know what a newspaper is? Just checking. But that's the thing. Is their life can be so scattered, but yours doesn't have to be because you're old enough to know that you're either all in or you're not. Are all your chips of your life, is every part of your life pushed to the center of the table? Have you given everything to the Lord? And if you haven't, why not? And if you haven't, will you take those chips that you kept back and now push them to the center of the table and tell God you're all in for real? Let's pray. Father, as a picture of being all in, I see a vision in my head of your Son, our Savior, on that cross. When he said those final words, when he drew his last human breath. And Lord, that he did that for me. That he did it for all humanity. Lord, can we please be all in for him, for you? You gave the ultimate sacrifice for people that can't give themselves to you. I pray that your Spirit come and move among your people, not through only through this church, but through all your churches. That your Spirit just give them the conviction to give themselves completely to you. And Lord, if 10 people in this church would do that, my goodness, we would have a revival above revivals. The fire would start and keep burning through anyone that walked through these doors. I pray, Father, for each of us, that we may come to you, trust you, have faith. We love you, we honor you, we praise your holy name. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, all God's children said, Amen. Flashback of grade school. I love that old stuff. God bless America. God bless you. See, your challenge is really daunting this week. If we think of those men and women that left this country and left their lives in a foreign land for you, for me. If we think that our Christ walked this earth, could have called down legions of angels to get rid of everybody, but instead God loved us so much he sent Christ to die for us. Shouldn't we be giving him all of us? He gave us his very last breath in order for us to have eternity. Now, I don't know about you. I can't speak for you, and I would not try. But this message brings darkness to my heart because I'm shameful for the parts of my life I have not given him. And that's our challenge this week. I don't expect you to give all of your life in one fell swoop. We should. We should just go be able to, bleh, right? And give it all to Him. Just purge it all and give it all to Him. But we don't. Because up here, we think we got to hold on. So get two things. Two things this week. Concentrate on two things that you have tried to give to God. Maybe you gave it back and you took it back. Maybe there's things that you just feel like you have to hold on to. Give it to Him this week. Tomorrow is Memorial Day, when you're taking time to remember those who died giving us our freedom. Take those two pieces of your life. Put them on that altar. And take your hands off them. Walk away from the table. Don't pick your chips up. Walk away from your table. And see if you can do that for a week. See if you can do that for 2 weeks. And psychologically, they say if we can do it for 21 days, then it's not a habit anymore. And we won't do it again. Can you do that? I know that you can. Because you got the Spirit of God in you. You got the power of God in you. All you got to do is call it up. Have a wonderful day tomorrow, this afternoon. Enjoy yourselves with family and friends. God bless you. I love you. If you need anything, you know what to do. Just reach out. Touch somebody. That should be a slogan for a phone company or something. God bless you. I love you. Peace. I'm out. Lisa, would you close this?
Father God, Lord, thank you for this time that we can celebrate in memory. And it is solemn, but Lord, we thank you for those that have given their lives for our freedom. And most of all, we thank you for the one that gave his life for our soul. And I pray, Lord, that as we go throughout this week, that this not be a day, that this is something that is a lifetime. Lord, we pray your protection, your guidance throughout this week. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Mm-hmm.